Good. It felt weird to be here and weird to be here.
Okay. Sorry. She can kick me under the table.
Yeah.
Speed it up. All right. We all ready?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, April 13th, regular school committee meeting. If you'd all join me by standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I will run through our agenda quick and then we'll get started. We have first tonight recognitions. And then we will have our first opportunity for public comment. Then we will have reports to the school committee from student council, our liaison reports, report from Hopkins School, the trustees of the schools, assistant superintendent's report, the school committee chair report, superintendent's report, and then an athletics winter update, which we will actually, unless there's any objection from the committee, be moving the athletics winter update to just prior to Dr. Kavanaugh's report. Under new business, we'll have the athletic field committee recommendation. We'll have a, oh, we're actually moving that one out of order too, aren't we? The vote to ratify the MOU. We actually will be moving our vote to ratify the MOA with the Hopkinton Teachers Association until after executive session. Then letter C, the expense transfer from Mr. Dumas, as well as a capital project school department article warrant 17-064. And then under old business, we have an athletics field subcommittee appointment, our second opportunity for public comment, our items by consensus. Then we will enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining with the HTA. And then we will reconvene in open session to take a vote on the MOA with the Hopkinton Teachers Association. And then it will be adjournment. So at this time, Dr. McLeod, recognitions.
Yes, so our first recognition is National Geography Bee winner Alexander. Sasha, are you here? And Foman, did I say your last name correctly? And he is here with Ms. Grady. So why don't you come on up to this table over here to be recognized? Wow, Sasha, so geography. Did you have to win first at the school?
Yeah.
And then what happened?
Well, then there's like a placement test.
Yeah.
That you have to score. You have to be the top 100 in the state.
In the state, wow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you have to go to the state B.
And where did that take place?
Chicopee in Western Mass. Mm-hmm.
And how did you place?
Sixth.
Sixth.
Wow. Wow.
And why do you love geography so much?
I don't know. I feel like it's just interesting to just know about all the cultures and the world around you, physical features, political features.
You know. Incredible. Ms. Grady, what would you like us to know?
I just would like you to know a little bit about him. His name is Alexander, but he goes by Sasha. He's on our eighth grade in the orange team. And his teachers remarked about him that he often teaches them things, most especially in mathematics and science and social studies. He taught Mrs. Oles a great deal about Alexander the Great, and he doesn't even remember. He has a passion for electronics, correct? Well, that's what you told me. he brings an awful lot to the plate as a student. He's one of our high honor students consistently. And every teacher I talked to from 7th and 8th grade told me what a delight he was to have in class and how much he brings to the class. He definitely has a passion for geography, but he has a passion more than anything for learning. He's a definite scholar, so we're just so pleased to have him in school, and to come sixth out of the entire state is amazing.
Really incredible. Sasha, what, is it okay if I ask you what stumped you?
I'm glad you asked.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, because I'm sure none of us would have a clue, so tell us what it was.
It was just a question, like, for example, I believe it was, pearl harvesting is often done off of the shores of the Sulu Archipelago. In what country? I was pretty far off.
You didn't get that?
Yeah. No, but the good news is, in eighth grade, towards the end of the year, they study John Steinbeck's The Pearl, so he'll have all his pearl knowledge and background, so he'll be ready to beat that question next year.
Yeah.
Right?
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Do you know the answer now?
Yeah, I know the answer now. It's the Philippines, but I didn't study too much into that one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, so let me ask you not about what stumped you, but what are you looking forward to in high school?
I don't know, probably the expanding of knowledge upon these topics that we already learned in the middle school.
Yeah.
It would be nice to have an enriched understanding of that.
And do you have any idea what you want to study, like when you graduate? Is that so far away?
It's pretty far away, but probably like some kind of science or culture stuff. Yeah.
What an incredible accomplishment. We're so proud of you, and we just really wanted to, you know, we read about the accomplishments of students in the newsletters and things, but to have you here when we can see you and get to hear you speak, it's just really great. So
Thank you.
Wanted you to know how proud we all are of you and your accomplishment and your hard work.
I suspect this is not the last time that we're going to see you
no.
at one of our meetings.
I'm sure it is
not.
It
was a pleasure to have you here. Mm-hmm. And thank you for not giving us a quiz. Sometimes that happens. We don't shine.
I didn't know the Philippines once. So.
No. Congratulations. That's really outstanding.
Awesome.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And next we have Annabelle Liu. I would like to introduce Annabelle. Come on up here with me, Annabelle. And I don't know who you chose to bring with you. Do bring that bookmark. Oh, Annabelle's bringing her sister.
Oh.
Come on up here, brave girl. Okay. Come on, right over here to the sweet chairs. So here, you can sit right here, Annabelle. I'll stand right beside you, okay? And here's your sister right beside you, too. And you can sit down. So Annabelle is a first grader, Annabelle Liu. Her bookmark won first place in the Massachusetts School Library Association Bookmark Contest.
Wow.
And she was invited to attend a ceremony with her family at the State House. I think Mom and Dad are there.
Wow.
Is that right? In Boston. Was that scary?
No.
Would you like to hold up her bookmark? So Annabelle is, as I said, she's a first grader, so she attends the center school where there was a contest that the librarian encouraged the kids to participate in. And this was, if we'll just turn it so the school committee can see it, and it's great that the camera can see it.
Wow.
On the bottom.
Yeah. So is there anything about the bookmark? I asked Annabelle beforehand, what was it, you know, what were her ideas about on this bookmark? And I think the candy cane made you feel hungry, right?
Well, we were talking about that, right?
But is there anything else that you want this school committee to know about making a bookmark? Yeah, were you surprised that you got chosen? Yeah. was it just kind of something you did? Because you were decorating a bookmark, and these are all the thoughts that came into your head? Yeah. That's awesome. Well, the thoughts that that came into your head really got recognized, and people thought it was pretty special. Do you want to add anything about your sister? No. Which is why I'm standing here, because I knew that Annabelle wasn't going to want to say much of anything. But we're very, very proud of you. And I hope you keep drawing, and I hope you keep expressing your ideas, because ideas that are in drawings are sometimes just a way that you put your ideas down before you write about them sometimes, right? Yeah. So let's give a round of applause to Annabelle. Thank you.
I think Annabelle's only about the second winner Hopkinton has had go to the state.
Wow.
Really?
And we have not had one, I think, for at least 5 years.
You follow the bookmark contest?
My son won it.
Oh!
He was the first.
Wow. That's awesome. Yeah, I remember when Julia was in first grade, she got like honorable mention, and it comes with like a big like gold like emblem on it, and so she thought she had won. I had to explain to her that she got an honorable mention.
That's really, really exciting.
Very well done.
Great of you, Annabelle. Now you're really... Oh, she's leaving.
She's on vacation.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, we're cutting an April break now.
You're standing between her and spring break.
It was very brave of her to come, though. I know
it was.
She did great.
So thanks for
coming. Thank you. Congratulations.
Is that all for recognitions tonight?
So, yeah, because the Hopkins...
Yes, that's it. And did anyone else have any recognitions this evening? Sometimes.
Well, I just, is somebody going to say something about Kenyan Runner Day?
I'm
still on such a high. It's the best event and so much fun. There are a couple people in the audience who were there participating. Just outstanding. So congratulations to Mrs. Carver. It's a tremendous amount of work, but so well worth it. Just the opportunities that opens up for the kids to just bring the whole world to Elmwood School is incredible. So I just am still smiling from this morning. It was awesome.
Yeah, it was a fantastic event. And I got to actually stay and go to my daughter's class, went to the media room and got to interview Wesley and Caroline. And first of all, I didn't know he was in Parliament.
Yes.
Yeah. So he starts talking about Parliament, and I was like, when does he have time to run? So, and they were asking him, like, his favorite places to run. And so he started naming off different countries and areas of countries, and it was just amazing, like, all the places he's been. But he definitely said that Boston was his absolute favorite marathon, and it was the best one, and that no other marathon welcomes them like Boston. So it was just it was a great experience, and also just amazing to me thinking while we were there that we are the only school in the entire state that gets that experience. Yeah. So it was phenomenal.
And I loved how he called out to the kids that you know us. Like, you have taken the time to study about our culture and, you know, our country, and it makes us feel so special because we come here and you're not asking us questions like, do you live in trees, right? And I just thought, I was just so proud of the whole thing, and you're right, Anne did a spectacular job. It was focused on the kids. It was just such a wonderful, wonderful, me too. It's just been all day. It's just been so great. So we should ask her to do it a monthly event. Whatever, all of us.
Yeah. With the confetti cannon.
Confetti cannon.
Great. Well, thank you for mentioning that, Jean. So at this time, I would move to our first opportunity for public comment, if there's anyone here from the public that would like to come up and speak. Okay, seeing no takers, we can move on to reports to the school committee, and our first report tonight is from the student council.
There's not.
I was confused by the number of people.
Well, I know
there.
We kind of thought.
Yeah,
I thought they were here. No?
No,
although we were a little hopeful because
they are students, but they're not here for that.
Report is often by Ryan, and I forget Ryan's last name, but he gave an amazing speech today also at Kenyon Runner Day. So I was hoping we'd see him to be able to congratulate him because really it was a very inspirational speech. So But we'll get the chance the next time we see him.
Next time.
So liaison reports. Has anyone had any meetings since last week, since it's only been a week since our last meeting?
Nope.
Wow, we're moving right along. I do have a small CPAC one just because I want to make sure that the school committee is aware of an invitation. So I know in our last meeting I did mention that the next CPAC meeting is May 16th at 7, and that that'll be before your reorg meeting. The CPAC has actually invited the entire school committee and is planning on inviting the two candidates for the two open seats to that meeting in order to familiarize the entire committee with the CPAC and what their current discussion issues are, as well as welcoming the two new school committee members. So I just wanted to put that on your radar again because they were asking me about it this week. And then
I think that was actually it. There wasn't anything else. So I just want to just bring that out there. I do plan on attending that meeting just as kind of a handoff type thing, but just to put it on your radars for that week to try and attend, and it's typically held in the lecture hall at the middle school. So,
if there's any confusion about the 16th, you were going to mention that because it might have gone in a letter. They might have seen it in the newsletter.
Right. Okay. So if you happen to get the CPAC newsletter, there was the top item said that the school committee was meeting with him on April 25th. That's from 7 to 9, which was a surprise to me because I didn't know about the meeting. It was meant actually to be a meeting between the CPAC board and Dr. Zaleski. And so there was a miscommunication there, which is what prompted me to understand how if they wanted the whole committee to try and come to their CPAC meeting. And so that's what we agreed on. And certainly we'll talk to Megan about getting that posted since if the entire committee's there. But if you happen to see the notification come out from the CPACs, usually they do a weekly newsletter, but sometimes it's not been weekly lately. But if you got it, it came out either yesterday or the day before. If you saw school committee on there, we are not at that meeting. So just for any confusion. And that is all I have on that liaison report. And except, I guess, because of my role as chair, I'm liaison to the Board of Selectmen, and I can tell you what happened at our meeting, but I probably would save it for our for my chair report since we have a couple of other guests here. So I'll give you an update in a few minutes. And right now we have the Hopkins School, the school signage and bench proposal from Mrs. Bellello.
Hi, everybody. I've brought three of our fifth grade students who are a member of a Girl Scout troop. I have Elizabeth, Morgan, and Lucy here, and they have some important information they'd like to share with all of you.
Good evening, Dr. McLeod and school committee members. We thank you for inviting us to speak at tonight's meeting. We are members of GS Troop 68067. We are here to discuss the proposed buddy bench that our troop would like to donate to the Hopkins School for use on the playground. This year, our troop has been working toward our bronze award. The subject that we chose is bullying. We began working on this project during October, which happens to be the anti-bullying month. Our first part of the project was to host a spirit week at Hopkins School. Many students and teachers participated by wearing their favorite hats and mismatched socks to school.
And in addition, we have taught a lesson on bullying and self-esteem to a few younger Girl Scout troops. On May 5th, we are hosting an I Am Day at Hopkins. This day will celebrate our classmates' special and unique qualities. We are also working on a PSA that we will tape later this month at HCAM, as well as a survey on bullying will be continued in the fifth grade health classes at Hopkins. The final part of the project is to present the buddy bench to future students of Hopkins School. We earned the money for this bench by selling cookies, necklaces that we made, and spending a Saturday at the recycling center. On Tuesday, we held a vote with the help of our town clerk, Mr. Deegan. We chose four no maintenance benches and asked our classmates and teachers to vote on their favorite design.
We hope that you will support our effort to put a buddy bench and encourage new friendships at Hopkins. Thank you for your time. My name is Morgan Gedman.
I am Elizabeth Howard.
I'm Lucy Joseph.
We noticed that not everyone has someone to play with at recess. A buddy bench is for kids who have no one to play with to come and sit. That way, other kids know that they need a friend.
Thank you.
So as you can hear, this troop is one of many groups at Hopkins that have really decided to become very active members of our community. And I think seeing community service rise up in young students like this is really exciting to see. And they're coming before you to ask for permission to erect this bench that they've raised money for. This week, it was really neat having the town clerk there, and he brought the large box, and the students were all able to vote the way that you would vote a long time ago. So it was pretty neat to see everybody in the school voting. So they all picked the design that they'd like to have, and this troop has raised the money for it. So we're just asking for permission from all of you that we can erect this on our playground.
So we know it's on the current playground within, you know, the structure of the playground, and that there's no cost. And I love that there's no maintenance.
Yes.
You chose maintenance-free
styles.
That's really forward-thinking.
And what style got chosen? Because I've seen the one at Elmwood, and I've seen the one at Center. What does the one at Hopkins look like now that you're proposing?
Well, we don't know yet. We're going to find out tomorrow.
Yeah, because there's a rainbow bench, a tan bench, a black and green bench, and a teal bench.
Oh, cool. Hard choice.
Yeah.
Will you send us a picture of the one that wins? I would really like to see it.
Yeah, all right.
There's a lot of ballots to count. The machine is a really neat machine, but it doesn't do the counting. So they will be working hard with their fellow
on your vacation.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow, I think we're doing dedication. It tomorrow.
Wow.
That's dedication.
Mrs. Bellello, I think this is at least the third time this year that some students from Hopkins School have reached out to the school committee, and I don't remember that ever happening so frequently before in the past, so I don't know what you're doing, but you have really got some engaged kids at that school this year, which is tremendous, and this is so generous that you girls thought of this, and you spent all this time raising money, and this is the gift that you're giving back, and you're not even going to sit on it because you're fifth graders, right?
Yeah. They'll come visit, though, right?
You'll come visit, but you won't even see it at recess, so that's very generous.
Thinking of the future.
Yeah.
Do any of you have younger brothers or sisters?
Yeah. I do.
You do, so you'll get to hear the reports on how well it gets used. I look forward to hearing more, and I echo Gina. It is nice to see so much engagement from Hopkins.
It's an age where building community service is really important.
It's
so we've talked about hoping next year that we can build in a community service club at the school because the amount of interest in taking part in their local community and abroad is just tremendous at the school. Very exciting.
Did the town clerk tell you that he went to Hopkins School?
He actually saw his old teacher.
Yeah.
Miss Jordan, I believe, was his
teacher. Isn't
that
hard to picture him there? So talk about giving back to your community. There he is. You know, he's our town clerk. So,
and girls, your troop leader, she's here tonight, right? Mm-hmm. What's her name?
Miss Carrie Howard.
Well, her full name's Carrie Howard, but I call her Mom.
Well, that's a compliment. Unless you're mad at her.
Well, I do want to congratulate you also on such a great presentation, and your speaking was amazing.
Yes.
So that's very hard to come and be in front of a crowd of this size, which we don't even usually have a crowd of this size. So you guys lucked out tonight. And on top of that, speaking so so professionally, it was really a joy to listen. And I mean, I for one think it's such a fabulous idea. And I have a Girl Scout troop myself, but they're brownies. So we'll have to give some thought into how to come up with such a great idea like you guys did.
They raised the bar for you.
I know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Distract the drivers. You're in trouble.
Sorry. I don't know if this is strictly necessary, but I would like to make a motion that we gratefully accept the gift of a buddy bench from Girl Scout Troop
68067.
I would second that motion.
Thank you.
You're welcome. There's a motion by Mrs. Birchman and a second by Mr. Graziano, and all those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
And it's unanimously passed, girls, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both for, thank you all for coming on your first night of spring break. My goodness.
Have a good time. Well, their troop leader told me that some kids have already left for Italy.
Oh my gosh.
Have a good time. They're spending the day counting ballots tomorrow.
The only other piece that I was bringing forth was to ask also at the same time that we would have permission to erect the sign that has been purchased by the HPTA. I believe in my memo I laid out the rationale for this sign. We continue to have a lot of issues with people finding Hopkins School and driving by and not knowing where we are because we don't have a sign right at our school. And the HPTA had offered to help us fund it. And so the purchase of the sign has been done and completed, and we are excited to put it up. We are looking to put it up in front of our community garden, so that would be right there to announce the school. And as part of the sign's purchase price, they will, again, not costing you any money, but the HPTA has funded it for us, so it will be erected right there to announce Hopkins School as the middle child in Hopkinton.
So. And I assume Mr. Rogers is aware of the installation?
Yes, I passed along the memo to him as well.
So. Okay.
That's good, because once you drive by it, you can't
turn around. Oh, yeah. Turn around.
You're stuck.
I'm enjoying all these proposals that come forward already paid.
So
easy to say yes to those.
Yes.
Do we? I don't think we need to vote on this, right?
No.
Okay.
No. All right. Thank you. Very
thank
much.
You. And I will work with Mr. Rogers to make sure we thank put you. It in exactly the right spot.
Can we get a picture
spot.
Of the sign too?
Absolutely.
I don't drive back there anymore.
Sure will. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a great vacation.
Thank you.
Have a great
weekend. Yes.
Happy
vacation.
Okay. Bye bye. Great job.
All right, so at this time, we will have the trustees of the schools grant with Dr. Cavanaugh and Mrs. Graziano.
All right, Mrs. Bellello, do you want to just...
Yeah, sure.
Sure. So we do have the trustees of the schools grant members here with us tonight, and we really do want to thank them because they have very generously given us a $10,000 grant that we have been able to use to create a science laboratory at the Hopkins School. When I arrived in Hopkinton just almost a year ago now, we became aware of the grant, and Kathy and I talked about it, and we thought that a really nice thing to do with the money would be to create this science lab. And it was very timely because we are at the onset of new science standards in Massachusetts, science standards that are founded in inquiry, and science standards that engage kids in the practices of engineering, not just science phenomena. And so I have been working very closely with Mrs. Bellello all year. We have really thought hard about the kinds of things that we want in the lab. And the very exciting thing that happened today, I'll let you talk about that, because the big truck finally came.
So one of the things, we were trying to figure out the best way to spend all of the money, because $10,000, though it seems like a lot, school furniture is not cheap. And we knew that we wanted to try out the furniture we had first and foremost to see if that was really what we wanted to spend money on, or, you know, how necessary that would be. So we have been using the lab as a lab space this year for various scientific inquiry-based labs. What we realized is with two grades and 22 classrooms, that the tables I was able to maneuver from around in the building, though wonderful big tables to use, are not enough for that many classrooms. And so looking at the space, thinking about chairs, thinking about science labs, we did decide to purchase actual lab science tables and stools, and they have arrived today. I'm excited to report, and the great part about arriving today is that Mr. Flannery, our head custodian, they're going to work this next week because all of the stools need to be adjusted to the right heights. So there's quite a lot of work, but once you are able to come in and observe and see the lab in action, we now have enough space that we can have both fourth grade lab experiments set up for different classrooms to use, for example, landforms, where they use large materials, large bins to model various landforms. At the same time, we could also do electricity labs and use tables for that space. So the room itself is coming together now that we have two science CTLs, curriculum team leaders, thanks to the budget that has been put forth by the school committee. We are able to have teachers who have been working really closely together with me to think of the best way to set up the space to make it inviting and a space that all of our classrooms can cycle through, and next year it will be in full force. So this year we've been piloting it with several of the labs. Now that we have more tables, the stools, we can make it a really multi-purpose use in there. So that was one of the purchases that we've made, is purchasing the actual lab tables and stools. We also have adopted a new science program called STEM Scopes, which we've been piloting and working with a publisher. And there's a lot of different components, but the key exciting part is that there are a lot of inquiry-based labs. And so we've been able to purchase what I call durables, things that will be used to run various experiments. So for example, at fifth grade, they'll be doing a lot with astronomy, and we will be able to do models of learning about eclipses with lamps and models of the Earth and the Sun. So the students will all be able to go through these various lab modules and inquiry-based experimentation in our lab space. So those are two of the big areas we put a lot of purchase of the money into. The other piece is we wanted to make it inviting. So we've been working on creating, you know, walls that really make this announce that it's a science space. We do have a projector in there, and one of the last pieces that we're purchasing is something to help that we can project other things up and use the space really so that wherever you are in the room, the teacher can be working in various locations. And right now, a lot of classrooms will have two classrooms in there at once because it is so large, which gives us a lot of opportunity. Fourth grade, they do animal adaptations. And so we've been in that lab space, and you can have students working in various stations. So some students can be working with a teacher using the projector, computer, working on learning through a video, while other students are cycling through and doing at the tables actual inquiry labs. So it gives us a lot of opportunity to be able to have 45 students and two or three teachers working together in science. Is really exciting and not something you see in many fourth and fifth grade schools in this country. So we're thrilled to have you come in. Once we get all that equipment set up, it's a lot of work, a lot of materials, but it's very exciting.
Yeah. And it should be there before the end of the school year. You can come in and tour. I think it's going to be awesome. That's so great. Thank
Sounds
you
amazing.
So much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We would love to have you come in when we're actually using this space, and you could come in and see students learning in action.
Sounds great.
Yep, we'll be there.
I love that.
Thanks.
Yes, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Sure. It's a great contrast to the meetings where we're having to coming in.
At this time, we will be having the athletics winter update with Mrs. D. King. And I believe first up, she's going to discuss the Alpine ski team update. But you can bring up whoever you want. Yeah.
Whatever you want. So I'd like to point out to everybody that Ms. King was just playing. She was just playing in the student staff games.
Yep.
And
Dr.
Kavanaugh and I had the opportunity, I think Jean and Nancy were down there too, to take in some of the game. And I was like, where's Dee? And Dr. Kavanaugh said, well, she's right there. And I'm like, where? You know, because she looked one of the kids. But she looked just like one of the kids. Like, so you did. Yeah. And just like you could tell that she was a real pro out there on the courts.
The glory days are over, unfortunately. That's why we have these guys here to take over.
But Dee, come on. I'm thinking, this is our AD, and look at what example that you're making, and the kids love you, and there's so much enthusiasm, and it just, thank you for being here. Thank you for being you.
Oh, thanks for saying that.
And
really
she's
nice.
Like, you know, can I come, like, right from the game? I said, please. And same with the kids.
Yep.
You know, Dee asked if you could just, you know, and thank you, Lori, for moving this report so
appreciate
that you guys could get on with your vacation.
On with the vacation for them.
There, I had to say all that.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for having us here. It's so nice for us to be able to bring some athletes just to talk about their winter season. So I have a quick recap of the sports that aren't represented here, and then if okay with you, I was just going to let the athletes give a recap of their season. So I'm going to
start before you, if that's okay, and then I'll let you steal the show. So, all right, so I know that middle school wrestling was something that we began this year, which was really exciting, and we had 8 students participate in that, which might not seem like a lot, but is actually really a lot for a middle school program, especially in its inaugural year. So we were really excited about that. It helps certainly grow the high school program, but it helps create another opportunity for our middle school students at the 6th grade to try a sport and maybe latch on to that due to different constraints, numbers and space and everything else. Other middle school sports are 7th and 8th grade or just 8th grade. So this year, with your approval to expand wrestling to 6th grade, which is a sport that doesn't, we don't have a lot of constraints with the space and those kinds of things. It was an awesome opportunity for those 8 students to have physical activity and be part of a team atmosphere. So thank you so much for your approval on that. And it was the coach was really happy and it was really successful. So we really, really appreciate that. Our boys basketball team this year finished 9-11. They missed the tournament by 1 game, but they battled injuries all season. So for them to get within 1 game of the tournament was really pretty amazing, given the injuries that they battled. Our wrestling team, as I spoke about, it was awesome for the 6th graders to join the middle school program, but they had a great season with the young team and had 3 athletes go on to states and all states, which was fantastic. Our cheerleading team had a rebuilding year under a new coach, which was exciting, and they have a really young group, so they were really enthusiastic. They were practicing all the time in there this winter, which was really fun to see. So they're excited for the upcoming year. Our boys indoor track team went 5-5, and they competed really well at the TVL championship and at states, and both coaches felt that their team exceeded expectations this year. Our girls hockey team, which is a co-op partnership with Dover Sherborne, they are not actually under the umbrella of the Hopkinton Athletics. Dover Sherborne sort of houses them, and we graciously send our athletes there. And we had, it was, what was really exciting was that it was about 50-50 this year. So it wasn't majority of students being from DS. It was a real nice combination, and 2 of the captains were from Hopkinton, which was really exciting, and one was represented at the All-Star game. So that was really exciting. And so that covers all of the sports who are not here. And so first, let's lead off here with David Antakis here as a captain of the Alpine ski team. And as you all know, since you've heard many presentations about our enthusiasm regarding the starting year of the Alpine ski team, it's something that as a school we were really excited about. We are so grateful for your support in having it be a pilot program this year. I could not be more proud of the team and the program. So I'm going to let David speak a little bit about it, but just huge gratitude to the school committee for allowing us to explore that program and to really get it underway. So go ahead, David.
Yeah, so just to start off, going off Ms. King, on behalf of the whole team, we just want to thank the school committee, the Hopkinton High School Administration, and Ms. King for working and supporting and establishing this Alpine ski team, because we knew it was a lot of work to get it going and to get a new varsity sport off the ground. And we also thank you for your continued support throughout the year. But for the first year, I thought it was an absolute success. We had 15 racers to start off for the first year, but it was a good mix of freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors. So hopefully with that, it can continue to grow and keep going as in the following years. We also had an exchange student participate, Albert Lee, so that was exciting, and he did very well. And he's from China.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
So I could practice my Chinese on the chairlift with him. we had a great mix of experienced and unexperienced racers, including myself. I was new to the sport of alpine ski racing, but with the coaches, Coach Nancy and Coach Dan, they were outstanding coaches for the, with their experience, and they were very willing to teach all of us beginners and teach us all the techniques and all of just how the sport works. And it was just incredible of them welcoming us, and as well as the experienced racers. We had one of our racers, Allison Marr, go on to states, qualify for states. And our team ended up third place overall. So hopefully next year we can continue this growth as a team and as individuals, our racers.
Thanks.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks, David. And it was a really fun year. I was fortunate enough to have the opportunity to go to Mount Wachusett and see the state races and see Allison compete. And it was just such a positive atmosphere. The ski culture as a whole was just so supportive. Such a nice group. You had all different towns and teams together bonding. They had food tents and everything else. So it was just a really nice atmosphere and a really supportive group. And our coaches were phenomenal and real, so experienced. We were so lucky and so enthusiastic and just really sunk their teeth into the first year of this program. So again, thank you so much. So we'll go down the line and I'll introduce each of our athletes we have here, and then I'll give you guys just a few minutes to talk about your sport. So we have Isabel Giordano, who's captain of our indoor and outdoor track team. Rachel Zale is going to be an upcoming captain of the swim and dive team next year. Emma Lakasha, captain of our basketball team, and Will Pickens is the captain of the boys hockey team. So if Isabel, you can start off just by talking a little bit about the indoor track season, that would be great.
Well, hey, Isabel, before you start too, we just want to also say congratulations to you on your speech this morning, because both of you were phenomenal, and also I just kept thinking I need to encourage my kids to do track so they can go back to Elmwood and escort the athletes. Yeah. So yeah. I hope you had a good day today as well.
It was really fun. I was so happy. So the indoor track team did really well this year. We were undefeated again, and we were Tri-Valley League champs. We also won Division III state relays, which had never been done for us in Division III. And then we lost by half a point at the state meet, but we had never come that close before, so that was really exciting. We had a lot of girls go on to all states, and then even teams go on to like nationals, where we placed fifth in a sprint medley relay, or not fifth, we placed seventh in a sprint medley relay, and we got a Massachusetts all-time record.
Wow. Fantastic.
And you're on that team.
Yeah.
And Isabel's on that team. Isabel's very humble, and she's also going on to run cross country and track at Dartmouth next year.
Wow. Excellent.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Good job. All right, Rachel, you want to take on swim and dive?
Yep. So we had a really good swim and dive season this year. We went undefeated in the TVL, which made us TVL champs, and we also won the TVL championship meet at the end of the season. There were a lot of great moments throughout the season. For example, our girls team beat the Wayland girls team for the first time ever. We've been swimming them for a long time, and this is the first time we beat them. Probably my favorite moment from the entire season was the Ashland meet. It was the meet for the TVL title, and it was really close. It came down to the last relay, and I've never seen so many people get so excited at a swim meet before. but yeah, we ended up winning that last relay, and that made us TVL champs. Also, we did really well in the postseason, which is like sectionals and states. There was a lot of good competition. And it was a really great experience. And our divers actually ended up doing really well. Maddie Staus and Lissy Annenberg placed second and third at the Division I state meet. And so we were really proud of them. And it was overall a great season.
Great. Thanks, Rachel. And it was, I admittedly had never really been fully integrated into the swim culture before this year. And I was so impressed with the team chemistry, you know, with athletes in the pool, and to see how enthusiastic and spirited the teams were for each other. Not only, you know, Hopkinton for Hopkinton, but Hopkinton cheering on other teams. There's just, it was the sportsmanship, I thought, at the swim and dive meets was really top-notch, and it's something that I was really proud of as I sat there and watched the team. So we have some really competitive, high-level swimmers and divers. But when you looked out there at all the kids, they all just were in it together. So it was really something that, as a school and town, that we really felt proud of. So awesome. So this is Emma Lakasha, and Emma will be going to play basketball next year at Colby College. So Emma, if you want to talk about basketball.
Love it there.
This year really has shown how far we have come since we've gone under our coach, Coach Greco, and in my 4 years being here, this has definitely been the most successful we have ever been. And it comes and starts from the chemistry that we have as a team. We have always been so close, and so has the girls' basketball program, been a very close program. And I think we can attribute so much of our success to that. And one of our biggest goals this year was to beat Medfield, and we did.
Yes.
So that is something, and by 31 points.
Side note.
But that is something that we could, 2 years ago, never even imagined to do. They were these, like, all-star girls, you know, that were just so competitive, and we kind of, this year, we just took them on head-on, and it was really an exciting point in our season, and because of that, we actually shared the Tri-Valley League champion title with them, and so that was a great accomplishment for us, which we haven't done since 2006, so it's been 11 years, but, you know, turning it around, and then finally we made it all the way to the Central Finals, unfortunately losing to Medfield, but only by 7, so. But, you know, this season has been so, it was such a remarkable season. We had 3 Tri-Valley League All-Stars, 2 Metro West All-Stars. So, I mean, it just shows the talent that we've had on our team, the coaching that we've had. We've had people come back, you know, Carrie Chatton, she played here at Hopkinton, comes back and assists for us. So all our coaches are so dedicated. So, yeah, it was an awesome season.
Awesome. And Emma also won the Metro West 3-point contest between all schools, so she wouldn't tell you that. Nice honor, but she won that, so I'll add that one in. And finally, we have Will Pickens, and Will is continuing his education at Boston College. Go Eagles, right? So Will's going to talk to us a little bit about the hockey season.
The hockey team this year had one of the best seasons we've ever had. We finished with a regular season record of 17-2-1, which is the school record. We won the Mark Bushnell tournament, it's a Christmas tournament, for the second straight year. We came in second in TVL. Unfortunately, we lost to Medway for the TVL, basically the TVL championship at the end of the season. But we had great support from the student body all season, which really helped. And then in the playoffs, we came up a little short. We lost in the second round to a team that ended up making it to the state championship. And we lost in double overtime, so it was close. And we had a good amount of TVL All-Stars. I think, I don't know, 4 or 5. So it was a successful year for us, I'd say.
And if anyone had an opportunity to attend any of the hockey games, then you know the spirit that Will is talking about. But it was... I will say that final game was the most exciting high school hockey game that I've ever seen. And it was, the level of competition was so high. The kids just, I mean, you guys left your hearts out on the ice. It was really amazing. And to see that level of competition between two teams, and as Will said, they went into double overtime. And then the team that beat them, Old Rochester, ended up going on to beat the teams ahead of them by a lot. So it shows you where Hopkinton fell. Is they could have continued. It was a tough early matchup for us. But overall, I thought it was really important to bring some of the athletes to talk to you tonight, because I can sit up here with my piece of paper and tell you, but they really bring it to life when they're in their athletic arena, but also when they talk about it. And we are so proud so many of them go on to participate in sports in college. And those who don't necessarily play on a varsity team are continuing their athletics, whether they're in clubs and intramurals, and it's always woven into who they are. And especially the representatives that we have up here tonight are role models, leaders, who are, I'd say, exemplify what it means to be a Hopkinton Hiller. So I'm really proud of you guys, and I appreciate you coming on the night of your vacation to speak to the school committee and share a little bit about the winter season and about your respective sports. So thank you.
We've never had an athletics update with the student athletes. I mean, that was such a different and wonderful experience. So thank you.
I'm so glad. They talk about it. They're living it every day. I get to watch it, which is really fun, but they're part of it, and they put so much of their time and energy, as you guys know. I know that a lot of you are parents of athletes, whether at the high school level or younger, so it's really time-consuming and takes a lot of energy, but
they're really proud of what they do, and we're proud of them too. So thanks for having them.
So the wrestling team,
yes,
at middle school, will it continue,
yeah,
next year?
Yep.
So I know
your support.
Right. So, but you'll invite new sixth graders.
Yes.
Any cost to that team?
No, actually, this is something that I like to present. There's no additional cost. It's actually just additional user fees.
Because
there's no cost. It's gym space. We're in the gym anyways. It's taking a few extra kids to, and it's exhibitions at that level. So it's not like we're paying these big entry fees or anything like that. And they use, even if there might be minimal entry fee costs, but it's totally offset by user fee. So it's actually a little bit of a profit there for us to be able to maintain that beautiful wrestling mat. Yeah. That was so awesome. So it was really exciting. And our wrestling coach is a humble, hardworking, dedicated coach, and he has been so appreciative and grateful for the support of his program this year, both in, you know, the mat, so something of physical equipment, but also just that there was an active interest taken in his program and the support. So I know I can speak for him in relaying his gratitude and thanks, because he said it to me all the time, and I was like, I'm really not the person to thank, but it made a huge difference. So thank you.
Well, what I would want to say to you, Dee, is that the parent of the sixth grader that approached this actually had approached me first, because we play softball together in the summer.
Okay.
And I had directed her to you and to Dr. McLeod, and she is extremely impressed with you, and she's also an assistant athletic director at another district, and just her words were, you're a breath of fresh air, and that you're so open to discussion and having new ideas for the kids, and that she was just thrilled that you even took on the opportunity and then ran with it this year, as opposed to saying, well, we'll see next year. So just as a compliment to you, even the parents are noticing the difference. So I just wanted you to hear that, because I
thank
heard
you
that
for
directly
saying
from
that.
Her. So
I really appreciate that. And I also wanted, I know that I will send this out to all of you, but I wanted to also invite anyone who's able to attend on April 27th at 7:30 in the morning, which I know is a little bit early. We have a breakfast honoring our future collegiate student athletes. So any student who's going on to participate in college athletics, whether Division I, II, or III, we're just going to have a breakfast brief to honor them. And we do have, Emma had mentioned the her assistant basketball coach, who Carrie Chatton, who is a Hopkinton High graduate, and she's going to be speaking to our students. They don't know that yet, but that's okay.
No, they're watching.
That's
our
okay.
Show.
They are all watching, so but that's okay. It's okay, because it's a nice announcement, and she is. I'll give a more formal introduction of her, but she has played Division I sports. She is an Olympian, drafted by the WNBA. And this is a Hopkinton High grad, so just to address our students. So it's really cool, and these kids work so hard, so they really deserve to be honored. And so it's just, if you're free and it's something that you want to come to, you're more than welcome to attend. We'd love to have you there. But it's just something that we're excited about to honor the student athletes.
I'm so disappointed, because Carrie actually also plays softball with me, and Carrie has never once mentioned any of her history that way. The only thing I knew about Carrie going into softball is that she had never picked up a softball bat before. And let me tell you,
I'm sure she's probably really bad at softball.
Had no problems whatsoever.
Yeah, I would guess.
I'm so thrilled for her to have that opportunity to talk to the students, because she exudes the caring of any sport and athleticism, so that'll be fantastic for them. I wish actually I could go, but when you said 7:30 a.m., I realized I'm on a flight that morning at 7:30 a.m., but
that's
it sounds
okay.
Phenomenal.
Maybe we'll have someone take it. But yeah, Carrie's a huge asset to our school, and she's just very humble, so given the fact that she would never share any of that information, so that's our job to share it for her sometimes.
And so continues to give back, because she's also a first grade girls basketball coach.
Oh, goodness.
Yes.
Other things that I don't know that she just does in her free time, and she's a detective down in Rhode Island, so she's just,
not to be messed with.
Yeah, just, don't mess with her. No.
Steve, my second question is regarding the Alpine Ski Team update, and this is just like a placeholder for us, but we know we need to budget for
the following year.
So this is year two of no cost?
Correct. We'll be entering year two for no cost.
Just for you to help me,
yep.
Given that we're not going to have Ralph to help me, remember, mm-hmm. We need to remember to budget for
yes
for yes. the Alpine ski team.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah. Ralph, you don't want me to bother you in September? No.
He will be unreachable.
So it's a 2-year pilot. And I remember in this update, we needed to remember
absolutely.
To see how it was going, knowing that second year. So it sounds like a wonderful opportunity.
Yeah,
not only the fact that they placed third, but just hearing, what was his name?
David.
David mm-hmm. talking about how he'd never skied before and how much he learned from the coaches and just such an opportunity for kids to learn something new. Mm-hmm. And so it sounds like it's going great. I know we have another year, but we need to think about budgeting.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, and I can't think of another varsity sport that you can start as, well, he's a junior, you know, having never played it before. I was talking to somebody the other day who said her daughter didn't play kindergarten soccer and in first grade thought it was too late to join in because, you know, I think kids start sports so early. So I think it's wonderful to have an opportunity for kids that just want to try something new to be able to participate. And clearly they were very successful. And so thank you for that opportunity.
Thank you.
So we're not cutting you off by any means because we'll see you in a little bit. But you can hang out there if you'd like. We have a couple reports. No one's got to take your seat. So if you want to sit there, you can. Or if you want to sit in the comfy seat, you can. But I think we next have the assistant superintendent's report, right?
Okay.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay.
You can wait if you want.
So I wanted to talk just a little bit about MCAS 2.0. We have been getting from DESE information in dribs and drabs, and I feel like now we are in sort of the thick of testing. Elmwood and the high school and Hopkins have already done their ELA testing, and so we have math and science in different places on the horizon. But there are some changes to the MCAS 2.0, and I thought it might be wise to share that with you, but also to share that publicly. So this year, the tests are computer-based. The only grade level in the district that's not taking the test online was grade 3 at Elmwood, and the plan is to get them to that place for next year. This test has full alignment to the 2011 ELA and math standards, and that was not the case actually before. We have now the kinds of questions that don't just beg sort of a knowledge base, but now they are transcending that and doing what I call meaning making. There's that need for application, for analysis, for synthesis of information. So the test is requiring a different kind of thinking from our kids. And hopefully this will give us some kind of clear assessment for next grade level learning and for college and career readiness, or at least that's what the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is telling us will happen with this test. So just so you have a little bit of a framework for the kinds of questions that kids are being asked, the two things that I want to point out here are the narrative writing to text task. So in third grade, for example, 15 of their points went to that narrative writing to text task. And in a few slides, you'll be able to see what that sort of looked like for them. For third graders, the expectation from DESE was that they would be able to write about 2 pages. In grade 5, they also had the narrative writing to text task, and their expectation was that they would write 4 pages. In third grade, there was 1 informational or analytic essay, and that should be about 1 page for third graders. For fifth graders, there were 2 of those, and again, that would be about 1 page in length for fifth graders. So you can just sort of see the what I call cognitive endurance. Kids were testing for quite a while, and there was a whole lot of reading and writing going on while they were doing that. So that was quite a challenge for them. With the math, and you'll get to see what some of these questions look like, but there were multiple choice and multiple select. So what multiple select means is that back in the day, if you were taking a multiple choice test, you would, by process of elimination, be able to take some of those answers out of there, maybe make an educated guess between 2. But if it's multiple select, there can be 2 correct answers, 3 correct answers. So that changes the test taking for our students. You really have to know the answers, and you have to know which ones are correct and which ones are not correct. There were short answers, and those were typically only, you know, a single word or a number, but those are ones where you don't have choices. You have to do the calculation or the computation and come up with the answer on your own. But then we also had open response questions, and open response questions are significantly longer. And for students who were in grades 4 to 8, there could be 3 to 4 of those. And for students in grade 3, there were 2 to 3 of those. So I wanted to share with you this particular slide. It used to be that long composition existed only in fourth grade. And one of the things that had happened over time is that, you know, teachers could pretty much teach kids how to write that narrative and how to include certain pieces, such as dialogue or some form of figurative language. And over time, it became, I don't know, rather perfunctory, I guess. What has happened now is kids are given this reading selection, and this is what we mean by the narrative writing to text task. So they are given a text, they have to read it, and what they do is either write a prequel, what happened before, a sequel, what happened afterward, or you write from another character's point of view. In this particular example, students are asked to write from another character's point of view. So in this story, I don't know if you can read it from where you're sitting, the narrator tells us that he and his dad have always gone on a father-son camping trip, and they invite a boy who's never gone camping along with them. And as you can even look through these first 10 or 15 lines, what keeps happening is the dad keeps rationalizing and saying, well, this is just a minor setback. So when they ask these students to write from another point of view, the person who is the guest in this scenario becomes the narrator as the kids are writing. And you can imagine that what they really need to be attentive to is how that kid is going to respond to all of those setbacks. So there is not just a writing piece here, but really a close reading piece. And it assesses not only how well a child writes, but also how well a child reads and is able to emulate that kind of writing in his own. So that's tricky, I think.
Is that third grade?
I think that was third grade on a practice test last year, yes. Yeah.
Lord.
Yeah, I know.
I don't know if I'm smart enough for elementary school.
This is coming from the parent of a third grader. Are you smarter than a fifth grader?
Yeah. Are you smarter than a third grader?
Can you take a third grade test?
It feels like the last few weeks that being on school committees keeps
proving
to
us. So here is a 4-point multi-part item. And so students had to do that first part of the math, and then part A hinges on part B. Then they go to part C, and part D hinges on part C. So if you were doing this test online, and you answered just the first part, and you got to B, and you thought, oh, I'm going to go back to that later. If you've answered any part of that, it wouldn't pop at the end and tell you that you had not completed that one, if any portion of it at all is done. So for students taking this online, they had to learn things like how to do bookmarking so they could bookmark that page and return to it. So there was a lot of instruction around the technology for our teachers as well. And we have to remember, this is the very first time our students have taken this online. You know, there may be other districts who have taken this previously online and have a little bit more experience with it.
Can I ask you a question about this?
Of course. Yeah.
Not the actual problem.
Who's Chad?
So the part B, C, and D all relate back in some form, or they're sort of progressive, right? Do they get,
correct.
So if they miss A, does it factor that in?
If they miss A, without question, they're missing
okay,
B.
Okay, so that's what I was wondering. So if you miss, even if you do the operation right on B, if you got A wrong, you're...
Correct. Yes. It is. And that's a 4-point multi-part.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of points there to be lost.
You're off making
you're laughing at us,
and
we're all sitting here like horrified as
to what the kids
have been saying. They have a lot of scratch paper, even though they're doing this online. I hope they
Yes, they do have a lot of scratch paper. Yeah. And one of the things that Vanessa had said to me about watching the students take this test at Hopkins is that we started that SRSD writing where kids now, we hope, have internalized a form of graphic organizer so that they know exactly how to organize their thoughts before they write. And she did say many of the students were using that as she walked around. She could see them using it. So that was encouraging.
Okay.
I think we maybe at his fundraiser need to challenge the Board of Selectmen to like take MCAS with us, and, like third grade.
That would be fun.
We get the instruction first on how to do it.
This is a good
that's
idea.
That's a fundraiser. While I think that's an interesting fundraiser, I don't think anyone in town would attend.
I don't think I don't think I could like bookmark a
I don't think we'd want
page
them,
to go back and and you can't use your calculator on that.
Scratch paper.
She's like, so, no, Jean.
If the kidding. Problem does allow you to use a calculator, it will be electronic.
Oh.
So you have to pop up the electronic
gotcha.
Calculator.
Oh,
tell them about the ruler.
Oh, yeah, I'll tell you about the ruler. So you also have to learn to use the electronic ruler, because if you asked your teacher for a ruler and you picked it up and held it up to the screen, it would not be calibrated with what was on the screen, so you would not get a correct answer using the physical ruler in your hand. You would have to use the electronic one that's provided to you.
Oh, which makes sense, because they don't know what device you're using. The monitor
exactly.
could be a different size.
Right.
But now you have to manipulate the ruler on the screen in order to
yes.
measure. Right.
Somebody's going to ask for my diploma.
Unlike a calculator, doesn't feel like a life skill.
Yeah.
Exactly. Hey, my elementary diploma.
Correct.
Back.
Wow.
All right. Let's see. This is one that is one of the multiple selects. So when they say which two conversions are correct, students would have to choose the two correct ones.
Oh, but they tell you two. So you, it's not like
in that
which
particular
are
one.
Correct.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's a little nicer.
This is the answer eliminator, so that there's, you know, another one of those sort of built-in tools for our students to be able to get rid of that. There are, you know, the state did give us some online practice questions, but they came, I don't think, until February, and there's also a program that they have offered to schools called Edulastic. So you can go in there and build a bank of questions and keep practicing them using these kinds of tools. So that's been helpful.
I love this tool. So she says it very kind of passes. This is the answer eliminator, but, you know, you have to teach kids how to use this.
Mm, yes.
And, you know, again, you know, there are districts who've been practicing. We will not be – are you going to get the accountability?
Yes.
Right. Okay. I won't steal her thunder then.
All right. And just to give you a little background on accountability, I don't believe the state knows exactly what they're going to do yet with accountability. The information that we have here is just the latest information. But even as of yesterday, they were meeting at the Best Western in Marlboro to have more discussions about what accountability is going to look like for districts. So there are some things that we know that I will share with you.
I think next time you show us the outstanding results of our MCAS testing, you should show this right before it so
okay.
that you can, like, yeah. impress people with how hard the test is and how well they've done.
And how well the kids are
I
doing.
I actually think this would be an awesome Highlights from the Hill to, like, put these questions up, because I don't think parents have any idea what this is.
How rigorous the test is.
This is hard.
It is hard, yes. And it's a very different test from what it was five
yeah.
years ago. Yes.
Yes, you do not start by smelling your mimeograph.
All right, so these are just the changes in science. For this particular school year, we are sticking with the old standards from 2001 and 2006. Next year, the spring of 2018, our fifth graders and eighth graders will have a combination of 2006 standards and 2016 standards. They have told us which ones those are right now, and so our science CTLs are working to ensure that when the kids get to the spring of 2018, they are very well versed in those particular standards. And then by the spring of 2019, there will be the full transition to the new standards. So I think our lab at Hopkins is rather timely, as is our curriculum readjustment. The testing window, the ELA finishes on May 3rd, and math will finish on May 26th, so there's not much testing time left for our kids. And this slide here just helps you see the duration of testing, the number of minutes that kids really will be spending in testing time.
But they're untimed, is that?
Yeah.
So that
it is correct. These were only recommended times.
So kids, so they're, you know, principals schedule the recommended time, but they also schedule for students who want additional time supervision. So that instead of having the entire class have to sit once they have finished, you know, they devise a schedule that allows for supervision for those kids who choose to continue. And, in fact, they're encouraged to continue. They're not encouraged to just work within the window and to not feel uncomfortable if they want more time. So.
Good.
I think that's a helpful slide to see, too, because I think you talk about perception of parents. I think right. they feel like it's a lot more time than mm-hmm. you see up there.
I know. I actually asked the question because this is my first experience with this year, and I was like, so were you in it all day? And she looked at me like I was crazy. And I was like, well, I have no idea how long the testing is. So that is
very helpful. She thinks you know everything, Mom.
Yeah, I know. Mm-hmm.
It is still a substantial amount of time, though.
Oh, yeah, but not as much.
But that's to write a four-page paper
yes.
in an
right.
hour.
Yeah. Oh,
that's really hard.
The next slide just gives a couple of URLs, different websites that people can go to if they want to practice. And I can tell you that our teachers have been practicing with the kids.
Will this be available on the district website for parents to look at in the event that they're not watching tonight?
We can certainly make it available, yes.
Yeah, I was just going to say, actually, like, those links would be useful
That's
in
what
the
I was thinking.
Newsletters of the principals before the test comes out, because if they're – so I either heard of two experiences of the parents whose kids were super nervous about it or parents whose kids were very nonchalant about it. Mm-hmm. I don't know that I would have necessarily went and encouraged more practice with her because she seemed very nonchalant, so I didn't want to put more emphasis on it. Mm. But there were kids that were super nervous that maybe it would have helped them to go over it with their parents ahead of time. So that might just be a thing to mention to principals for newsletters in the future.
Yeah, especially sort of that calming thing, you know, that feeling for kids that, you know, you've had 120 days of school, you're ready.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In terms of the high school test, so right now our 10th graders will continue to take the old MCAS. So the first group of students who will take the new MCAS are this year's current 8th graders. They'll be the class of 2021. There are still all kinds of decisions to be made about high school. So will there be a college and career readiness test in grade 11? Will we begin to have a history and social science assessment? I mean, they've been talking about that for a lot of years. They spent some time trying to put that test together, and then just because of, I think, sort of, you know, money and other constraints, it hasn't happened to date. We still don't know what science subjects we'll have testing on. So right now there are four different tests at the high school level. There is talk that we might go to two, just physical science and biology. And should the competency determination move to grade 11? One of the disadvantages of moving the competency determination to grade 11 is if there is a student who doesn't pass in grade 10, they still have six more opportunities to take that test. If it moves to grade 11, it eliminates the number of times and the amount of time they have to take the test. They are considering changing the level descriptors. So right now we have advanced, proficient, needs improvement, and warning. They are thinking about going to exceeding expectations, meeting, partially meeting, and not yet meeting expectations.
Just because.
Just
right,
because.
How much did they
just
pay somebody to come up with that new?
It's a lot of hours. All right, so these are probably the important slides here. How are we going to know how well our children did when we get to the fall of 2017? So if you are currently a level one or a level two school, and obviously in Hopkinton, you know, as we reviewed last fall, the middle school and high school are level one, Hopkins and Elmwood are level two schools. So for those schools, there will not be any leveling for next year. Only schools who are level 3, 4, or 5 will continue to have those levels because they also get services alongside the levels. The test results, they are telling us now, and I've actually put quotation marks around their language, that they will be used to set a common assessment baseline, and DESE is planning to revise the district and school accountability system. So essentially, our spring 2017 scores are going to become a baseline. And the only thing that I wonder about those baseline scores is, will they rank order them so that Hopkinton will fall somewhere in that continuum of 351 cities and towns in Massachusetts? We don't know the answer to that yet. DESE is going to report next-gen MCAS results for each district and for schools, but what we're going to get really is that normative measure of achievement. There will not be SGP scores this year. So the old MCAS and the new MCAS, it's like comparing apples and oranges, so you're not going to get a growth percentile score for individual students or for individual classrooms like we have been getting for the past 5 years. High school will still get SGP scores because they're taking the same test. And you'll remember that in past years, you've always seen those bar graphs, and they have shown you the last 4 years of MCAS. It won't be until the fall of 18 that you'll actually get to see that sort of side-by-side comparison of 2017 and 2018 together. And they'll try to build again so that you see them in four-year increments. And that's all I've got for you.
Because,
it's enough.
Because this is computer-based, did the results come out sooner or no?
They are not telling us that the results are going to come any sooner.
Okay.
And I know that, you know, we say that it's computer-based, but there will still need to be human beings reading those four-page responses, one-page response. So it will
correct.
Still take some
okay.
time to make
yep.
that happen.
That was really interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very, very helpful. And, I mean, I've been here for a long time, and I'm embarrassed to say how little I knew about that. I really think that's quite eye-opening. So I think that was a great presentation, and however we can sort of push that out more broadly to parents, I think is excellent.
Thank you. Yeah, we'll get that on the website for sure. Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Kavanaugh.
Thank you.
Definitely, I agree.
So Carol has clearly been working very closely with the principals with all of these strategies, and actually her presentation got pushed out not one meeting but two. So as she was looking at those links, we had talked about the very thing that you're talking about, is that the whole idea was to get this out to families. But the practice that Carol is describing is something that, you know, she has been meeting with principals and sharing, and not only sharing and meeting, but ensuring that, you know, kids are being exposed to these different strategies that would be very new to them. I think I saw a link on one of the principals' newsletters that went out, but I think just, you know, because I'm aware of the timeline and where we are in it, but definitely getting it linked to the main webpage. Mm-hmm. And then I think maybe as I'm listening to you, another presentation in the fall, you know, because before those scores come out, we want parents to understand how it's going to be different this year. To what they've had in the past, and why is there no SGP? So I think having Carol come back, and maybe we could even do a forum in the fall before the scores are released. Could be a fun time.
It could be fun.
People will still get letters? Or
yes.
Oh, yes. Okay. For sure. Yes.
They just won't have comparisons in them. They'll
right.
be.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Yes,
thank
like you.
You
won't be able to see an individual child's growth from one grade to another.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay.
Thank you.
So on to the school committee chair report. I do have a couple items tonight. The first item is that after our meeting last week, the CPAC did approach me and very much was appreciative of the school committee's time and attention on the ELA policy, as well as they just were very happy to even be able to make public comment and have us be listening. And if I was to quote from one of the emails, they were excited as to how many people were aware of the different issues going on within special education department. So I wanted to pass that along. In addition, that they again reiterated, and I know it was spoken about during public comment, but they also reiterated the fact that they were really pushing for parent, teacher, and team chair involvement in the creation of the handbook. So just to keep that in mind as that process continues over the coming months, that was requested. In addition, so I met last night with the Board of Selectmen it was a full presentation for the board on the budget, but the piece that I met with them about was to discuss our decisions that were made on the various warrant articles at our last meeting. It was an emergency meeting of the Board of Selectmen, which most of you probably know that there was a large pipe burst and flood through town hall. So what I can report to you in case you didn't know is that it's likely that all of the second and third floors will be gutted. There are a number of concerns, which I won't go into because they hadn't fully figured out all of the damage and or chemical issues that may be happening because of it. But they thanked the school committee and especially Dr. McLeod for being so amenable to allowing them space and to use of the space of the schools. And I also extended as well the fact that any of the town departments that are
boards that use meeting space in the town hall are certainly welcome to contact the administrative team to find out what availability we had in our buildings and let them know about middle school library and high school library and lecture hall and things being available, because a lot of those boards have the public meeting requirements as well. So they were very appreciative of that. Very high praise to you for reaching out so early. In addition, so there was a thank you to us for our consideration of our warrant articles, and not a lot of questions for me. I let them know what changes we had made and what decisions were made. I did let them know that not all of the decisions were unanimous, and that we were still concerned about the impact in coming years of the parts of the warrant articles that we didn't put forth for town meeting. The last, it seemed to me from the conversation that I was a part of that the Board of Selectmen were satisfied with where the budget ended up. It did end up at a 3.0%. So you certainly can follow based on their meetings. It wasn't a lengthy meeting because of the fact it was emergency in nature and they weren't posted for that night. So, but in addition, I did ask at the end of my portion of the presentation, was how our FAQs could be linked with the warrant articles to understand, because it basically said to them, we haven't done this before, but we really feel it's important that the citizens get background on our warrant articles prior to town meeting and not just hearing a presentation from us, but actually having some basic information in front of them ahead of time. So Mr. Kamalo said that, you know, as soon as we finalize them and can get them to him, they will be actually physically linked in the online document. What's still not clear to me is who or how, if there's any printed copies at town meeting. So I still feel like that's one area I didn't quite clarify, but I was trying to be expedient during the meeting with them last night because they still had to meet with appropriations and a few others, and their executive session had ran a bit long. So I did want to put that out there that our documents are going to be linked with our warrant article. So when we do review them with Dr. McLeod or whatever comments you provided, they're not going to get lost in some area. It's going to be the warrant article, the amount, and then there'll be a link at the bottom of the article with the link to the FAQ. So that's how it will work. And I think that's all I have. So Dr. McLeod.
Great. So Laurie had asked me to provide, this is a draft, and I was going to provide it last week, but then it got crazy late, so I offered to bring it this week. It is a draft. I want to remind the committee that we are typically given 4 slides. This is way beyond 4 slides, and I think it should be beyond 4 slides, because as you have asked me to, I want to tell a story, I want to highlight the achievements, and I want the money to be that the ask to be explained with respect to some of the other presentations that we have all talked about. So I'm going through it tonight with the understanding that this is a draft, and perhaps after tonight, you know, before town meeting, I can have a chance to make some changes, and I'm happy to.
I just think it's optimistic you put May 1st on there.
Oh. Well, thank you for that, John.
No, it's right. I'm just saying, you think we'll get it done in night one?
Well, it's not even the first. It's the 8th.
Isn't this like the first?
No, it is.
No,
it's the first. But was it 2 years
about
ago?
The fact
we
might not get to the school budget on the first night.
We didn't get to the school operating budget night one 2 years ago.
Yeah. I feel like we've always presented, though, no?
I think there was 1 year we didn't. The weed year we didn't.
Okay.
Can we ignore the pessimist one in the group right now?
So we will amend the date as needed. I think it's really important because I'll just say this first. I think it's important because it's the Hopkinton Public Schools budget that the thank yous go to the community. And as you know how appreciative I am of all of the people that I work with and all of the administrators, but this is the town budget that the town is supporting, and I believe that the thank yous and the acknowledgments need to go first to you and then to the community and the town board. So I would propose that that's how I would begin. Thanking for the support. You know, I love this, and I those of you who are there will remember my interview that this whole learn, create, achieve together
mission statement spoke to me as a candidate because I believe it, but I think it gets lost in just, oh, it's learn, create, achieve. So I wanted to take it apart and then look at these are the ways that we learn, create, and achieve together. So that's kind of the approach I took to the presentation. And I believe that the learning piece of this is all around the strategic initiative supported in the budget and the strategic plan itself. And when I come back on May the 11th, I will be reporting, because I wanted to make sure that I did that with the current school committee, on the strategic plan accomplishments of the year and the strategic plan recommendation priority initiatives for next year. That's work that central office has been doing, because it will in turn guide the school improvement plans that you're going to be hearing from the principals in June. So that's where I call out the strategic initiatives. You've seen this in previous presentations where I worked with Carol and we looked at the strategic initiatives that and with Ralph, the strategic initiatives that are supported in this budget. And we called out the specific strategic initiatives that were aligned. There are two slides on that we can speak to. You can see the preschool program evaluation, the effective instruction, the pieces that we call out in the budget that have to do with either changes in positions, changes in program, are all supported by the strategic initiatives. And I think it's really unique. I think we really want to celebrate it because we've been really sticking to the strategic plan and it's been a live document. And we often hear from candidates who are applying to the district who have done their homework and gone to the website how impressed they are. That it's not just a bunch of bullets. It's something that we're actually using to guide not only the decisions about what the initiatives are and what the priorities are, but what they're not. And I think both of those things are really important.
Before you move on off the speech, and this is just a stylistic recommendation, is that being in this room and being as close as I am to it, the green on green is a little difficult reading, and with that town hall being as large as it is, we might want to just consider the color scheme of the letters of the words because of the fact that we want everyone to be able to see it. So that's my only recommendation here.
That's great. Don't use orange.
Yeah, don't use orange.
You know, I'll have to get my color committee. But that's great feedback. It's true. Green on green is kind of your eyes crossed a little bit.
So the learn, and here's the create. I think the create piece is around, and I'm going to talk about the Metro West Adolescent Health Survey in a minute, but we're really, really proud about having an education that focuses on the whole child. And I know how much you enjoy having students come, and I'm always pleased when I see the wide range. I mean, those kids talking about athletics, and then all of the awards from the MICA Festival. I mean, we just, the jazz band that was here just last night. I mean, it was just, there's so much going on in the arts, in engineering with Doug coming last time. That's the creative part. That's the, we do really well, but we do really well because we have an education supported by the budget, supported by the town, that provides an education that focuses on the whole child, that gives students, like our Geography B winner tonight, the opportunity to shine, to come here and feel really good about something that he's really good at. And I feel very excited about that. And it's paid off because here, again, obviously the colors on my screen, and then when I see it on the big screen, Lori.
The white is hard, too.
Yeah. I'm seeing that now. But
this is good. This is your test run.
Thank you. That's what it is. So grade 7 and 8, I mean, look at these. I didn't choose every year, but I looked at a 10-year span. So if you look at where we were in 2006 and where we are in 2016 under these measures, under cigarette smoking, alcohol use.
Oh, my gosh.
Marijuana use. Yeah. I mean, fighting on school property.
Bullying.
Bullying victim. And this is this is the Metro West anonymous survey that kids take on their own. They have no reason not to be honest. The thing that despite all of these reductions, exactly, and, you know, life is very stressful. They're being honest. But it feels like the things that are reducing, I would like to say, or partially, as a result of the programs that are, and the focus on social-emotional health that are happening in every school in the building, and it's having a wonderful impact. You know, the lack of change under considered suicide, I would have to have somebody like Denise here to speak to. This is definitely not something that I could even begin to talk up to. It very, very complex issue. But I'm really delighted with the results. And again, kudos to our health and wellness, our principals, all of the things that are taking place in our schools that result in those kinds of statistics. Here we are, same results. I called out the same categories. At the high school, there were some additional categories, but I wanted to do a straight comparison, so there were a couple that I didn't include. But you can see, look at the reduction in cigarette smoking.
Mm. Or these are percentages?
These are percentages.
I know. It's so funny you say that, because I actually picked this up. I know you handed it to us last week. I picked it up this morning and was, like, perusing it, and I feel much better now that seeing 2006, but the 2016 ones still kind of disturbed me a bit. And that's from a parent of a young child, so it's one of those, like, yeah. This is a scary statistic, but, you're right. The reductions are really amazing. I mean, even the whole fighting on school property and all of those pieces.
And I think these, you know, you've said to me before, you've asked me, you know, to provide some results from all of the programs that have been supported over the years, and I feel like it's really important that these get included in our presentation at the town meeting, because this is because of the program that we provide for the whole child, that kids can feel good about something, can help them manage the stress in their lives. And as Evan has said, you know, so well, and has expressed so well, we're not going to take away the stress in their lives. In fact, maybe that's not a great goal, because life is stressful. What we want to do is give kids tools to cope with the stress. Well, that's going to be part of their lives.
And when you look at this, and I don't want to take us too far off the topic of the budget report or the budget presentation, but when you look at this, the typically unhealthy coping mechanisms for stress, we're seeing those go down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We're not necessarily seeing what is replacing them and what students are doing to manage stress. And absolutely, you cannot eliminate stress, but we talk all the time about helping them learn how to manage that for themselves in their life, because life is stressful. But so on both of those slides, that's kind of what jumped out to me, that, you know, the very negative coping crutches, whatever's the right ear, guidance counselor, whatever the right words are, but are going down. And so that's a positive thing. I think people would actually be quite surprised to see the reduction in marijuana use in particular. That surprises me, just because of how much attention it gets and the changes in the laws in those 10 years. So I think that's very good news.
Yeah.
I think this is entirely appropriate for a budget presentation where we have invested so much in social and emotional programming. I mean, this is the output metric, right? I mean, it's the same thing what we do with the full-day kindergarten, reducing IEPs for kids in first, second, and third grade. I mean, that's what this is for social and emotional learning. So I think the correlation is really clear.
Good. Okay.
And encouraged to see that the number, the percent that considered suicide in the high school had a fairly significant drop, whereas the bump
in the... When you look at percentages, that's significant.
Yeah.
So learn, create, and then achieve. And this is the achievement, this is the presentation that Carol gave around. And again, I wanted to, you know, introduce this by saying that we have a limited number of slides. So I had to make choices around highlighting some major achievements. But this says it to me. I mean, the best overall MCAS performance in the past 4 years. The middle school met their gap narrowing and became a level one school. And then the high school ranked fifth in the state, 82% of our students participating in APs and a 99% graduation rate. That's pretty incredible. And I'm going to get to the slide of our per pupil expenditure. And then Hopkins I had to call out separately because I thought it was really, really important. You've heard us talking about our high needs kids and about, addressing their needs, and particularly at Hopkins, even though they're still level two, you can see that they're really going in the right direction, because this is the population of students that would be addressing level two, and I am convinced
that if we had been leveled next year, they would have been a level one. Carol?
Mm.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
And so it's kind of disappointing that we lost the opportunity, because look at this growth under high need students. Mm-hmm. These are SGPs. So these are student growth percentiles comparing a student to other students across the state and the kind of growth that they're showing in high needs in 2 years is incredible. So the high needs, and then when you see all students with disabilities, it's something to be very proud of. Then I wanted to talk about the impact from programmatic changes supported in past budgets. You know, and I said it very intentionally, programmatic changes, because it's not one thing. It's instruction, it's materials, it's professional development. Yes, it's full-day kindergarten, but I'm kind of like, I feel like that's getting too much attention. I want to talk about the programmatic changes that have been supported in past budgets that have resulted in these kinds of improvements. So when we look at the percentage of kids, and this is, I just get so excited about this. This is the percentage of students receiving specialized instruction at our schools. At the center school in 2015, 7.4% of our students received specialized instruction. In 2016, 8.5%. And this year, only 6.6% of our students at the center school are receiving specialized instruction. That's what we should be seeing in a K-1 building. We should not ever be seeing more than that. We haven't even tried teaching them yet. So if they need specialized instruction because they have a significant disability, we absolutely are providing it. But what we're working really hard to do is not provide specialized instruction for kids where there's a learning gap where we have not yet even tried. Maybe they've just come to us, or maybe they didn't have a preschool experience, whatever the differences may be, or maybe they didn't participate in our full-day kindergarten program. And now there is a gap. But what we're working really hard to do is to say that doesn't mean they have a disability. Mm-hmm. So let's not slap that label on. Let's not be too eager to slap the label on. Look at the reduction at the Elmwood School. I mean, this is just makes me so excited. And then I already gave you some statistics at the Hopkins School. But the true population, if we're looking at specialized instruction, particularly in this area, should be at 10%. And I'm just delighted. I just can't even stop, because that's such an incredible goal, and it's all about all the things that have been supported in past budgets that you have supported, and that people have
allowed us to do. This is going to be printed out and handed out. I didn't know what the data was saying until you explained it.
Okay.
If you could say something about number of students as percentage of population requiring specialized instruction or something. Just if you get it, you wouldn't.
Yeah, like an asterisk with a little statement underneath or something. Yeah. I agree. I mean, when I know that you will provide excellent color at town meeting.
If somebody picks it up and walks away with a packet and doesn't know what this one means.
Thank you, Kelly.
Mm-hmm. I would say, can you put a big red bow on this and mail it to Mr. Manning? He's been waiting for. You know,
that wasn't the name I thought you were going to say, so yes.
I mean, he asks us every year during the budget process, absolutely, and I think this is such a great way to lay it out.
Yes, Jean,
I'm teasing about Mr. Manning. Just responsible reporting to show the investment, and I think it's...
And you've heard me say this, and thank you for trusting me, but you can't show this in less than 3 years.
Right.
You need to have confidence, and you need to have training and professional development and materials and all the things Carol's brought on and, you know, all the things that Lauren's been doing and I mean, all of it.
You've got absolutely, to have all of it, right? But I think it's very powerful to look at. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And
the 8.5 in 2016, we had, I said, what was that about? We had a lot of students with significant needs moving into the district that year particularly, which was directly related to full-day kindergarten opportunities. And that doesn't mean they're moving in and then leaving. It just means that it made it very, if I'm going to choose between this community and the surrounding community that doesn't offer it, then
I'm choosing Hopkinton. So there was that kind of increase as a result.
Is this whole presentation going to be part of the Know Your Vote event?
So I asked if I was going to be, I might have said, given the opportunity for an opening statement, and the answer was no. But I will be prepared with this on my laptop to pull up, you know, with evidence if I'm given, when I'm given the opportunity.
Yeah, and I didn't mean it as critique for not presenting it before, because I agree with you about the 3 years, but I just think this is really impactful, and so, you know, as many people as can see our story is great.
And then, you know, I love this slide. This is Vanessa's slide. It's just so incredible. Just that whole together, the education that focuses on the whole child that's supported by families and community. And I've said this over and over again, but, you know, in order to be able to achieve the results that we achieve, we have to have students that are supported at home. They're supported within the community. There's so many outside agencies and involvements that help to support our kids. And when they come to school, they come ready to learn, by and large. And so that's the together piece for me. I'm going to fly through this because you've seen it before, but this is the part, you know, that I think that up front in my mind needs to be here. This is what we need you to understand before we start talking about dollars. Now, here's the original request, and here was the reduction initially, and we came to a 4.13% increase in order to support all of the things that I just described. I wanted to point this out. I think it's an ongoing and important slide that we continue to do the things that we do within an 18% expenses by making choices, by choosing these programs need to continue. This is something we want to bring on. This is something we're no longer going to be supporting, and we do it all the time. And that's why, you know, we're seeing some consistency in there. I put in a slide just this afternoon with the additional reductions that the school committee voted at the last meeting, because I thought that was important to call out.
Is that HMS?
Or the MLS? Oh, yeah. It's supposed to be HMS.
HMS.
I did it after the Elmwood Kenya Day. I was a little excited.
Kathy, also the bottom one is system-wide technology.
Yes.
Okay. So additional reduction slide. It should say HMS, not MMS, and it should say system-wide technology.
And is it fair to put the athletic fields on there?
We never had a dollar on it. I could.
I think we kind of should get credit for postponing.
I don't know. I'm kind of like, I'm kind of not loving this slide. I mean,
I'm with you.
I don't have a good reason, because I feel like I don't know.
So I think I might. because I think it's, you know, we want to think about the conversation flow, right? So what you've just done in the first slides is really lay out all the achievements and telling a wonderful story. I think we don't want to put in. I mean, maybe we aggregate the number and just talk about additional reductions in capital, because, the athletic field's a great example. Somebody's going to stand up and ask, like, 15 questions about the athletic field project, right? Or the HVAC at the Hopkinton Middle School. We're going to have to get into the explanation of why the money we put up last year didn't. Not that I think we should be unwilling to answer any of those questions, but I think you're going to have a packed presentation. We're going to probably be tight on time anyway. I just think it gives people things to zero in on.
Well, these aren't in the warrant, and we're saying we're removing them.
Right.
So they wouldn't have known that they were even up.
There's no reason to talk. Yeah.
I honestly don't care. I mean, I'm happy to take it out.
Yeah, I think the whole this feels like a slide, but the whole thing should become about this.
You could save it as a backup slide if there are questions around. Yeah. What reductions were made?
I do agree with that, Jean, that if there becomes a conversation due to the fact that there were reductions made on the town side as well, for instance, sidewalks, and if people raise the issue of, well, what did the schools reduce? Mm-hmm. We do have this capability, but I don't think that this belongs in the regular presentation.
Well, to that point, though, I mean, that also might be why, like, it wouldn't be its own slide, but maybe it's that last number that you find a way to put in, right? That we reduced $277,000 of capital.
You probably add it to the previous slide.
Because that way you show, again, what we did, but you're not necessarily getting into the all of those.
Maybe in here. Maybe under reductions.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, like a capital line and just have it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
And then I feel like I did reduce this from two slides to one.
Yeah,
I thought, okay, come on. So I didn't want to be killing them with it. So when you saw this last time, it was over two slides. Yeah. And so I reduced it to one. I chose, you know, districts that I think
What about Ashland, though? People always
Ashland
know.
Is Ashland's. I think they're just below us, Ralph. I don't have the other slide in front of me.
I don't know, like, from an achievement standpoint, is that how we chose the districts around us?
No, Norwood's not so high achieving.
Okay.
I think people always wonder about Ashland since we're so
okay.
We're right on the line.
I can figure out a place
and
to put
the Ashland. The homecoming.
I think they're very close. I think Ashland, Hopkinton, and Holliston are very close. Do you know what? I chose districts that were similar in size.
Oh, okay. They're not similar in size?
Ashland is...
So maybe instead of calling
it... doesn't really matter, right?
So maybe... Yeah, so maybe... Oh, you mean in terms of students?
I would just maybe take out a Norwood or a Westwood.
It's still good. It's per individual pupil, so I'm not sure where size... Because I don't think it scales, right?
No.
Yeah.
It's per pupil.
Right.
Yeah, but I feel like there's an impact when it's a much larger district in terms of the, you know... I don't know, the percentage of the ratio between administration and whatever. But I will find out if the Ashland information adds anything to the slide.
Okay.
Okay?
Thanks.
But I mean, I kind of agree with Dr. McLeod on that, because the fact is that even though the district size is important in the size, but the town size is also different than Hopkinton. Like, a Norwood is far different than a Hopkinton size, like from a town perspective. So even though your spend is... I understand what you're saying, is that the per pupil spend is divided by the number of pupils and what the overall spend is on the schools. But the overall tax impact to a town is different per household if your town size is bigger.
Well, and also if you have a higher commercial, I mean, Norwood has a higher
commercial base
than we do. Natick certainly does. So I think you can slice it a lot of different ways. Yeah. I'm just thinking, really what this says is there are a ton of factors that drive it, but it's... Per pupil, what does the town spend to educate a student, right?
That's the point. And I feel like if the Ashland slide adds anything, I would have to. I would find another one to take out. Kelly.
Do we know?
Okay.
But I think the point of the slide is to say we do all of this and look at what we do with your tax dollar. Right?
Yeah, so, no, I think that's great.
What's because these lag a little bit, right? Do we know what the year is?
Oh, that's a good...
Wikipedia is 2010. I was just trying to see how...
So this is just last year's.
Oh, it is? Okay. Oh. Okay, because I thought these were usually lagged a little bit.
So I think it's 15.
We should...
Yeah.
Okay. We should put the date.
Yeah. And does it add value? I'm sure it adds work, so the answer can be no. But does it add value to add a third column and just put sort of the ranking? Because Desi says, like, what number you are in the state, right?
I would love to add that column, Jean.
Because
I would.
That adds a lot of context that we can't list 351 towns.
That's a great idea.
I might change what's included right in here. Okay. That was a great idea. I love that idea.
This is a great slide.
This is a great slide. And I added to it, you know, as I was looking at it. So now we've talked about what we're costing, what we're achieving, what... How responsible we're being with the money that's appropriated to us. But then on top of that, I actually added to the slide that we originally had because, you know, I think that things just keep coming our way and without funding. And so this is more administrative time, most of these things, professional development that's required, the restraint regulations themselves. And we just had an administrative meeting earlier this week. The amount of training, ongoing training, to continue to keep all of our people safety care trained, which I've reported has resulted in incredible reduction in restraint, is significant. And, you know, we have minimal amount of time to provide any of the PD, so often that means bringing in substitutes to cover teachers, et cetera. So this was an important slide. Whoa, I guess that was the end.
The one thing we have talked about previously going on that slide is the technology-based testing.
Yes, that's what I was
going to say. And I don't see it on there.
I agree. That's what I was going to say.
So the computer-based
I guess I'm wondering how that has...
Because the fact that we have to worry about technology.
We have to add
technology
budget.
Yeah, but I disagree. That I disagree with, because we're not adding technology in order to meet the regulations of testing. We're adding technology because it's the right thing to do from an educational perspective. And when I hear people saying, other districts, not people, not meaning here, that's the reason they want to get funding, because they have to meet these regulations by the state, I feel like you saw the window of testing. That I would never recommend that we get all this technology just for that purpose. We have a technology plan because we know that this is what we need to do to prepare kids for the future. And by the way, part of what they need to be able to do is to take this test. So
okay.
I've never felt comfortable arguing that, although yes, it's going to be a requirement, there's so many other reasons why we need technology for kids.
Okay. We had talked about adding it, I think, one other time when we looked at this.
Yeah.
So that makes a
lot
of sense.
Yeah, I think someone recommended it, and I thought about it, and then I never kind of shared my thinking on it. So.
Yeah. CPR is coordinated program review, right?
Yeah.
Most people wouldn't know.
Oh,
they would think it was the other CPR.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I thought it was.
Okay. If you think of anything else, any other columns, any other changes, anything missing, or anything where you feel there's too much, happy to make any changes. I've got still a few weeks.
I think it looks great. I think what I would do just from a consistency standpoint is pick one color font and stick with it.
Yeah.
We've obviously given you feedback on the color issues with any...
Yeah.
And so, I mean, you obviously have that in mind, but I would just make it the same throughout.
Yep.
I'm sorry, Kelly, were you going to say
that? The template does that. That's the problem. So the color template itself, like when you populate it, so I just need to go in and override it.
Gotcha.
So that it's consistent.
My one thing was the learn, achieve, and create. Do you want to show it as a quote right at the beginning? Because then I know we know that that's what it is.
Well, I will add to it.
You'll read it. You'll say it out loud.
I will.
But maybe just to set the foundation for what you're doing.
It gets lost, right? It's just it gets lost as a banner.
Yeah.
I think this is really good. I really appreciate all the time you put into it. I think this is just what we need. And
this is so much more information than people have been getting. It really, I think, is great. I hope that they will be very happy to accommodate the one or two additional slides beyond the four.
Right. I agree.
Going back to the one slide, and I'm trying to articulate what I'm thinking, but it was on the reduction of kids getting specialized instruction.
Yep.
I think it's important information from looking at like what we've done budgetarily. I just want to tread carefully and making sure that people are not getting the impression that we're cutting people from special ed. I don't want it to look like we're cutting, and I don't think to most people it would, but to somebody who feels their child needs services and is looking for services, I would be afraid.
So, Nancy, I know exactly what you're saying, and I had a conversation with a parent about this just today as it pertained to one-to-one paraprofessionals. And her child's in the intensive program, and I said to her, we would never be talking about reducing paraprofessionals, but I understand that when you hear that in a larger context, you feel that that's exactly what we're doing. So I will frame it in a way that talks about the percentage in terms of needs.
And maybe how you're meeting them in regular ed.
That's right.
In ways that kids then don't need the specialized instruction because they're getting their needs met. Yeah,
I will be very careful with this slide because I understand what you're saying.
I also do think you should be prepared for a question, and there's certainly a logical answer to it, but, well, then why aren't the special education costs going down?
So that question is answered by Nancy's question.
Right.
For the very reason that teachers are addressing the needs of kids, whether they're on IEPs or not.
Right.
You know, so people who have some strategies that we can use with kids not necessarily specialized instruction, so that's a whole different program, but accessing the general curriculum by having additional supports within our staff. I will love to get that question.
Yeah, because it's not intuitive to most people.
It's not, no, and I've that's heard, all. Actually Mike asked it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So can I also recommend that, being that we do not have a formal meeting with all of us prior to town meeting, the night of town meeting, that when you make your revisions, if you could send it out to the committee, and I would just instruct the committee that if you have any comments, that they just go directly back to Dr. McLeod due to open meeting law constraints, but that way everyone would have an opportunity to look at it one more time and provide some feedback, because of the fact that we're not going to have that opportunity again.
You know, so I think, it's, again, this tells a phenomenal story, and you have been telling us for a couple of years that we got to wait for 3 years of data before we start to get this. So on night one of town meeting, we get 200 people, right? Maybe if you watch on television. I'm just trying to figure out. I'd like to figure out a way to get this out to as many people as possible. So I don't know. I mean, we can share it on the website. Do we have this? Is the state of the town?
It's on the 24th.
Okay. I want to ton more work for you, but I just think this is.
No, but what if we actually stated during Know Your Vote that if you'd like to have a preview of the school's budget presentation, will be available on the website.
And let's be clear. I don't think we should just call this the school's budget presentation. I think we should come up with. I mean, the whole first half of it isn't a budget presentation. I mean, I guess it's a result, but it's school's achievement and budget present. I mean, I want to get out there that this is like the best part of this is the part that shows all the money that has been invested in the schools and what it has brought us. I think the more people that see that, the better off we are.
And so I'm happy to share it in whatever way you want me to. I feel like without the story that goes with it,
commentary,
and the dialogue that goes with it, there's a lot lost. I'm always excited to do a forum. I'm just struggling with when we might do it. I don't want to take away from that event, education
and
foundation's event on that night. You know, I feel like that would kind of take away from them if I was offering a forum just before it. But
I agree, and I think, and maybe this is a conversation to have for next year, about, because this is a change to the presentation that we're making and how best to fit it into the sort of ramp up to town meeting cycle. Because I really, the Highlights from the Hill program is a great opportunity, and I suspect that your shooting schedule isn't going to allow it, one, to be filmed and sent out before town meeting. Yeah. But that might be, just going forward next year, it might be good to target one shortly before town meeting with a presentation somewhat like this, so that we can, link that and send it out. You can tell I caught up on them this week because it's at the top of my mind, but they're a really great format and so easy. People can just click on them. They don't have to set their DVR or whatever. And I thought it was it's a shareable way, to your point, to get out through social media.
You have a very busy schedule, so I want to lead with that. But, I mean, from an HCAM perspective, we could ask, right? If it's something you could fit into, because we've done that for other capital, like the school, we would call them and say, can we do one this week?
So I have a planning meeting with him next week, so I could ask the question, is there any way you can turn this around? And I could come to the studio, you can film it and get it out.
Because this is sort of way back in the day, we used to do an annual report that actually got mailed to everybody's house. You remember?
Yeah.
Which had, not necessarily this level of detail, but had more detail than you get at town meeting. And so maybe that's sort of the way to approach it, because this really is that. It's very comprehensive. Look at what's been happening.
Thank you all for your feedback. I will make the changes, get it out to you for additional feedback. We can also review it at our 6 o'clock meeting before town meeting as well, because we'll have time together. That's posted, and I'll follow up with. I'm happy to follow up with HCAM to see if we can. I think that's a great way of getting it out, Jean, and then we can you know, you can help to share.
You can share it. You can, yeah.
Get it out, get people listening to it. It would be me kind of basically doing what I just did and talking about it on the show. Yeah.
Right. But it's great information and very well done to be able to reuse it in multiple.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Nice to
okay.
Put that out there.
Good. Thank you.
So I know, Dr. McLeod, the next piece of your report was in regards to the fast facts documents, and in the interest of time, I just wanted to understand from the committee if we were rehashing those.
So
or?
They haven't seen the changes. So what everybody did is they gave you their feedback, and then Megan and I together put everything together. We compiled the feedback.
Okay.
Some of it was repetitive. So we would have to go through each of these. You're seeing it for the first time to see if this, and they're not meeting here. So I know. I was kind of worrying about.
Can we go out of order, maybe?
Well, I don't. If this is, this could take 20 minutes.
I guess the question, if there's one way to potentially wrap it up quickly,
okay,
from the meeting perspective, which is that if everybody feels like these are at least close, can we designate one member of the committee to work with you to finalize these for production? Because that way we avoid.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
I mean, that.
Yeah, because I feel like, I mean, I feel like even if we weren't potentially holding other people's evening, like, it, we spend a lot of time doing that.
Are you raising your hand?
I'll do it. Fine.
So we've shared them.
Not my intention.
You've all had input. Your input is reflected here.
I looked at the cupcake, John.
Your input is reflected here. So I don't. I think that it would be everybody's input, and
yeah,
it could be.
I have no objection to that.
I would
that.
Like it to be next week, however.
Well, in,
going away.
I'm here. No, I'm here.
It doesn't have to be, John. I was just
putting,
you know,
further feedback to you directly in the next couple days.
Yes, before.
Before you meet with.
Mm-hmm.
Before Tuesday, can I say? And then John and I will find a time to get together. No?
Yeah.
Kelly, I already have all yours in here. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I provided mine already. I mean, I can take
it.
A second look, but...
No, it's all in there.
Okay. Then, have at it.
Oh, congratulations.
Glad I came up with the idea to give myself...
You know, that happened to me at work recently.
Good job.
All right, so... Then, Dr. McLeod, did you have anything else for your report, since I cut you off on the rest of your report?
No, thank you for your feedback, and the only other thing I was going to talk about, Jean brought up during recognitions, and we've already talked about it, so it was the Kenyan Runner Day.
Awesome.
So, no, I have nothing else.
Thank
great.
You. We should bring the confetti cannons over to you afterwards.
Oh, that was awesome.
I know.
Yeah,
I have to say.
Only adjourn, just fire them all.
It made awesome. It very hard to focus at work after, I got to be honest.
Good for town meeting, though.
All right, so we'll move on to new business, and our first item would be Mrs. King.
We'll Are you awake?
Back. Yeah.
Are you sore now from sitting after the game?
I know. You sat in the hard chairs, too.
Take a big coffee chair.
I don't know.
Fall asleep.
Thinking about what I'm going to eat.
So I think you all have in...
I'm so hungry. I'm
so late. I think you all have in your materials the memo that we got from Ralph in regards to the... Is that what we're talking about right now?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. The turf... field design contract award. Certainly, Ms. D, if you have any, or Ms. King, if you have anything that you want to add to it, by all means.
I think just that, you know, it says it in your notes and in the packet, but just that, you know, after we had worked with both Gail and Warner Larson and asked them to give us proposals in terms of design costs, and special thanks to Ralph for his work in doing that. Ralph and John and Jean and Ed LaFleur, one of our subcommittee members, everyone put their heads together and worked to do that, but Ralph did the lot of legwork on that, so just thank you to him for that. But that after you know, we reviewed the proposals, there was drastic cost difference, and I would say the biggest point on the committee's recommendation to, one, appoint Gail as the designer, but also to factor in for full design fields 4 and 5 and 3. So there's kind of a two-part proposal here that the committee is, that the athletic field subcommittee is recommending to school committee. And one, we just as a committee felt like the group as a whole thought Gail had presented really well and had a good feeling about that. But then in terms of the actual design proposal, we thought we would be doing a disservice to the proposed project if we didn't get design costs for the full project that we're recommending in terms of the phasing. And the reason being is that in order to get what we think and what those who have expertise in the area of synthetic turf construction, to get a full scope of what the project will actually look like and to design it properly, we would need to know how, for example, eventually putting synthetic turf on field 3 would impact 4 and 5, and therefore, in order to do all that, we would need to get design for the full project. So I don't know. I think that, you know, Ralph or John or Jean might want to speak more to the financials, as because I know the recommendation was to utilize the gift account. So I don't know if someone else wanted to speak.
Can I just add a couple of details on the proposal?
Absolutely.
So the one thing is also, when we did negotiate with Gail, we talked to them about the need for support on public forums and meetings.
Yep.
Obviously, that was been very successful for us in other meetings. So they came back and added an assumption to the proposal that would include 4 public forums and town-type meetings to support this project. So I think that was important that we know that we have that in there so that as we have those forums, we have the engineer available to present and answer questions. The other piece is, from the schematic design perspective, we also looked at the, I'll call the political reality of doing the schematic design for 3 and 4 and 5, which is if we go to the town next year looking for construction money for 4 and 5 and we have a schematic design for 4 and 5 and either the question comes up about 3 or we talk about phase 2 and we don't have it to show people, we felt like that would be lacking and could potentially damage the support for the project overall. So even though we're not going to be asking for construction money for field 3, we've got the pretty picture and how much it's going to cost that we can show people so they get a sense of the entire project. And Gail was obviously willing to adjust their proposal and fit that into the budget that we have available for this.
Correct. Thanks for bringing up that point, John. That's a huge piece of it, because I think for any of us who have been fielding, no pun intended, but fielding the questions about this, though, it's always asked, why is field 3 not happening first? And certainly the committee has a legitimate reason, in my opinion, as to why we're recommending 4 and 5 first, both from I know when I had presented to you earlier, we talked about just there's more life on the track. It doesn't need to be resurfaced just yet, but will need to in a couple of years, which aligns with the phasing of the project. And also just the revenue potential of having 4 and 5, whereas if we started with 3, it's one field, and it's just not the same revenue potential. So we're trying to actually save the town money in the long term. And so there's been a lot of thought in the process, but John brings up an excellent point that if we didn't put field 3 into the schematic design, we feel that it would be a pressing question from community members. Why is, you know, even though field 3 is used for more than just football, but why is the football field not getting done, which was a big part of including that. Thanks for bringing that up.
Sure.
The other, just one piece that I'll add is that there was another, well, first of all, the original amount that came back to us was more than we could afford. So I want to thank all 3 of you and Ed as well for going back and working with Gail, as well as Gail, for being flexible and breaking it out and sort of parsing out what needs to be done in order to be prepared to go forward at town meeting next year and what pieces of the original scope of the proposal could be postponed until that funding was available, all in with the understanding of keeping the project, as you pointed out last week, John, keeping the project on track to still open, even though we're postponing the request at town meeting by a year, not postponing the opening of the fields by a year. So I, to be quite frank, didn't really think all those things were going to align. I was very concerned that that was not going to work out. And so I credit you guys for doing that, as well as Gail, for being so willing to work with us. And I think that, you know, that just really kind of reinforced for me that they were a great choice. And, you know, Warner Leishman has been great to work with the elementary school as well. But I know Gail was involved at Fruit Street. And I really feel confident in the subcommittee's recommendation to go forward with this.
So I had posed a couple of questions in strictly just about the account. And I mean, here's my confusion. And Ralph, I'm hoping you might be able to answer these questions. But when does it, like, when are we allowed to use an account like this versus when do we have to put it forward as, like, a capital request? Like, I guess that's where I had some confusion. And then also I don't feel like I remember, and we may very well have been working out of this account in past years, but I just don't remember using this account for much, and if there's restrictions on it, and also where the money generally comes from. So that's where I had some questions.
Most of the money that came, that is in this account, came from either the BAA or the HAA, mm-hmm. both of whom had made annual contributions throughout the years. There's also some new funding that's in there from the BAA and the 26.2 Foundation. And occasionally the school committee will also accept gifts from other organizations, and you have in my time here. And from the other organizations, there were no strings attached into what the uses could be. The HAA, BAA, and 26.2 Foundation funds sort of have some requirements, but it's really at the school committee's. You have the authorization, in particular with the old money. The old money helped pay for the bleachers at the high school, and in terms of that particular contract, there was also language in there to be used to further athletic programs at the high school. The 26.28 BAA combination makes some mention of the cross-country trail, and it also has more general language regarding athletics. So this account is fully under the control of the school committee. It's one of your revolving accounts, and it requires no further appropriation from town. It was set up, it's been here longer than I have, so I'm assuming that it was set up at town meeting as an approved revolving account, which only required one vote, not an annual vote on a revolving account. So the choice is totally yours. There are no restrictions on this other than the ones that I mentioned.
Okay.
And the capital request piece is because we're not asking for an additional appropriation, so it doesn't need to go through.
That's correct. Capital request. That's correct. Yep. You have the funding source to do this. You're not asking for some funding that doesn't already belong to you.
Gotcha.
What's left in this account after this is paid?
Off the top of my head, I don't know, but $120,000 is totally unencumbered, which means that it's not part of the cross-country trail.
Okay.
Although those monies are commingled.
This isn't borrowing from...
It's not borrowing from that one.
Okay, thank you.
And I think, in addition, this is also where we got the traffic calming, and that's been factored into
that's correct.
The analysis
that's correct.
As well. So
that's not
thank you.
Part of this money.
No, correct. That right. won't be impacted.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Any other questions? All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to recommend Gale Associates as the project designer for the athletic fields project at the cost of $116,775 to be funded through the central office gift account.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, Mrs. King.
Thank you
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you.
I really
thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Oh, don't worry about
break.
Break.
Oh. A great break. Oh, thank you so much.
Can
it's
I
nicely done.
Yeah,
sorry,
good.
Can
thank
I
you
say,
much.
Too, I know we're running a little bit behind on the agenda, but his name came up a couple of times, but I do want to make mention of one of the members of the committee, Ed LaFleur, who is a resident of the town who has been so incredibly valuable to this process, to the point where what we just talked about how we're able to keep this project on track without having the town meeting vote, would not have been possible without Ed, because he was the one sitting in the room saying, why can't we do this? We can cut this down. We only need this. Now, his expertise is in this field, but it just is, once again, we are so blessed not only to have the support of the community for our budgets, but the amount of talent we have in this community around these projects, and the work he has done and the knowledge he has brought to this project are one of the only reasons why we're in a position to keep this on track the way it is.
So can I just ask, so on track would put it to be set to be used in 2018 or 2019?
Yes. 2018.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Again, some things still have to happen.
Right.
But, when we were originally talking about backing out the capital article a year, we were talking about backing out the field a year, and now we're not. So.
All right. The next item on our agenda, we are moving to after our executive session. So letter C, expense transfers, Mr. Dumas, and he has provided us a memo. We now have grown very accustomed to the style of, so thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions or comments on the expense transfers proposed? None?
Please leave the template for your successor.
Yes.
Will do.
Speaking from someone that's not going to work with the successor?
On behalf of somebody who likes the template.
Thank you.
All right, so at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the expense transfers as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. All right, and then moving on to letter D, we have capital project school department article warrant number 17-064 in the amount of $26,297. And you all as well have a memo from Mr. Dumas in your agenda materials. Does anyone have questions on the payment of these invoices? No comments? All right. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant article number 17-064 in the amount of $26,297 to the vendors as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And then our old business, we have one item, which was discussed last week. And we have Mrs. Birchman and Mr. Graziano to present. Although there's no motion, so hopefully you have that too.
I think we can come up with one. just as this process has evolved, we didn't originally have a liaison to the Parks and Rec Department on the subcommittee. And I'm sure that we had a brilliant reason for that at the time. But I think as things have evolved, in particular, Dan Terry has been great about coming to all of the meetings and has been working with us in a smaller group about field management and whatnot. And so I think it's just I think it adds value to actually give him an official voice at the table, not as voting member, but as a liaison, as we have to the Board of Selectmen, to the Appropriations Committee, the Capital Improvements Committee. So I would like to add him to the – it doesn't change the voting structure or the quorum, but certainly lends weight to the voice that he's already bringing to the table and the value that he's adding, I think, to the process. So, So that's the issue at hand.
Any questions? All right. Would anyone like to make a motion?
All right, I will make a motion that we add a liaison from the Parks and Rec Department to the Athletic Fields Subcommittee as a non-voting member.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, we have our second opportunity for public comment. Is there anyone here to speak today? Thank you.
Thanks, Nina.
All right. So
We are on to items by consensus. I do usually ask if anyone has anything they want to pull out. I actually have a correction that I'd like to make on the March 16th minutes, because I didn't open that meeting. Kelly did. So if we amend that, I don't have any objections to having you in there. I just wanted to raise that because I know that was the meeting that showed up late to. Now, I don't usually catch those things either, but
I
have.
You didn't show up late. We started early.
I think John and I showed up late.
We started early to do the questions.
That's right. Yes. But I didn't open the meeting, so I just wanted to have that on record.
Did you get that, Nancy?
I did. Thank you.
So I think that we can still vote them all, but should we just say as amended?
Sure.
Okay. How do you want to work that one?
I can add it if you like.
Yeah, but you usually don't read them all individually. That's
no,
what I'm trying.
No, I can just say move to approve the unemployment as outlined below.
With amendments.
With the amendments to the March 16th.
Okay.
Okay.
That would be great. Yeah. I'm ready.
School committee, that would be me. The superintendent recommends the school committee move to approve the items by consensus as outlined below with an amendment to the March 16th school committee minutes, March 16th, 2017 school committee minutes.
So moved. Second. Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, I would seek a motion to enter into executive session for the purposes of discussing strategy with respect to collective bargaining with the HTA and to reconvene in open session.
So moved.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano, and this is a roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
And I'm a yes, and we are now entering into executive session. You can end TV. We are going to come back.
Did you bring that in there with it?
I didn't. Unconsciously. I used it to sign the warrant, and then I just didn't put it down.
All right. Yes. So we have exited out of executive session, and we will now be taking up new business item letter C, letter B, which is a vote to ratify the memorandum of
agreement
with the Hopkinton Teachers Association. And before us, we have a motion to approve the vote to ratify the memorandum of agreement with the HTA as outlined in the agenda materials.
Did you say you're going to say the dated out here?
Well, it's as included in the agenda materials. And then I would say, so I will make that motion, but also.
So I saw a motion, which you are going to make.
Can I make a friendly amendment on it?
Sure.
So moved with the friendly amendment that also authorizes Dr. McLeod to sign on the committee's behalf.
Oh, yes.
Second.
This one doesn't have to be roll call, does it?
Yes.
Oh, it does.
Okay. Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. And this will be a roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Did you get their names?
Don?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
And I'm a yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. And at this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. And we are adjourned at 9:34. Oh, not. Didn't get us in under the wire, I guess, huh?
Close enough.
You've still got one more
chance. Our next meeting our next regular meeting is both a public hearing and regular meeting on May 11th. 2017 here in the high school library at 7 p.m. We will also all be together at town meeting on May 1st, and I believe we'll be having a posted meeting for 6:30. Is that right?
Six. We're posted for 6.
6 p.m. At the middle school, and we will be enjoying town meeting for however many nights. Let's hope for two it is. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.